Blackstone Audio presents The Sinking of the Angie Piper by Chris Riley. This book is read by Andrew Eiden. Chapter 1. The front door to McCrawley's, made of solid oak, wrapped with wrought iron, and as heavy as a 7x7 foot crab pot, swings open toward the harbor to reveal a stunning view of Kodiak's main attraction, fishing. An array of seiners, trawlers, crabbers, and other commercial vessels are moored 50 yards away. If not for the fishing industry, Kodiak would be nothing more than a muddy village. Open during the day, the bar supports its town's commercial endeavor by serving an excellent fish and chip basket for lunch, which goes down quite well, I might add, with a pint of McCrawley's three-sheet porter, its signature ale. According to several outdoor magazines, nothing gets a person ready to tackle the last frontier better than a night out at Kodiak's finest brewery. But on those nights prior to the opening of crab season, unless a person is well known in the fishing community or just a bona fide idiot, it is prudent to stay the hell away from McCrawley's. On those nights, the joint is ruled by the Alaskan fishermen, some of the world's craziest and sometimes meanest individuals. And so, on our third night in town, I wasn't too sure about bringing Danny along to McCrawley's. We had spent the last several hours of the day preparing the Angie Piper to set sail the next morning, and even though I was anxious to let off some steam that night, I still had my doubts about dragging my lifelong buddy into one of the roughest places on Earth. "But what about Danny?" I asked, after Lonnie hollered for us to go get in the truck.
"What about him?" Lonnie replied.
"Well, he doesn't even drink. He'll probably get bored." In response, Lonnie gave me a shocked stare, as if I had just asked him how many crab were in the sea.
"You think Danny would get bored in McCrawley's?" he said, sliding into his coat and zipping it up. "And sitting alone on a ship you're going to live on for the next couple of months will be good?"
Even so, I returned Lonnie's bewildered gaze with a concerned one of my own.
"You know, Ed, I'm betting that boy can arm wrestle something good now, eh?"
Lonnie added. And then it hit me. Of course. Even though Danny's presence would most likely get us into trouble, as it often did back in high school, it was just as likely that he would end up winning us a shitload of money arm wrestling. "Go get in the truck, Danny," I said. McCrawley's is located along Resinoff Drive, west of the general store. Every fisherman, processor, and local yokel has made his or her way through the door of this establishment at one time or another. No one would argue that McCrawley's doesn't carry with it a certain homey atmosphere, one that is punctuated by a floor littered with peanut shells. All those salted peanuts make a person thirsty, and the broken shells do one hell of a job at soaking up spills. But people appreciate the hospitality found in free food, especially here in Alaska, where the winter nights are so cold and so lonesome that sometimes the only thing that will get a person through to the next light of day is the warm familiarity of food and drink. Danny and I were born and raised in Anchorage, a place that gifted us with its own sense of familiarity. Life was much different in that city than in Kodiak. In Anchorage, we had comfort and stability. Our routines were common to the average person. But we were adults now, so our priorities had changed. At least mine had. Which is why I got into commercial fishing, a career with routines like none other. Dangerous and difficult as this job was, the prospect of earning more money than I knew what to do with was tempting, to say the least. Danny simply didn't think this way. He was here because of me. This had something to do with the guilt I'd been harboring for much of my life. That I'd failed to defend Danny against his many bullies was only the half of it. At one time, my friend had seen the worst in me, and I had yet to reconcile with that. I owed Danny. Bringing him on board the Angie Piper was my attempt at redemption. The job offered good pay and an adventure on the high seas. He'd never come any closer to becoming what he desired most in the world, a Navy SEAL. When we got to the bar, I had second thoughts about bringing Danny. "I don't know, Lonnie," I said, once we'd pulled into the parking lot. A sea of rugged vehicles surrounded us. Stout 4x4.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.